Hello there, sword fans. Today I'm going to tell you about this sword right here. This is the Fiore from Albion. And a couple quick disclaimers before I get into the review. One, I don't study historic European martial arts, so keep my thoughts on how dynamically superior or inferior this sword might be with that context in mind. Also, this sword is secondhand. I did buy it with my own money, and it came to me in a condition that was, well, it showed some signs of neglect, some minor surface rust, things like that. And I used a Scotch-Brite pad that is of the same type of finish that Albion uses, like the ultra-fine Scotch-Brite pads to kind of clean off the rust and whatnot, but do know that it has a condition that is likely less than what you would get were you to buy one new. That said, it looks in good shape overall, and I think it's pretty representative of what you would expect to get from Albion, so hopefully it gives you a good idea if it's worth your money or not. There are a few other reviews out there of similar swords, and I'll include the links to what I was able to find in the description down below, but I don't see a lot on the Fiore. It seems like the Ringek is perhaps the more popular model. I don't see a lot of close-ups of the Fiore, so hopefully this will provide that for you if you're curious about it. All right, so I don't know much about Fiore, and honestly, I did look at some of the manuals, or at least what I was able to find online from what he had produced, and this sword doesn't seem to exactly look like it's bespoke to Fiore or something like that. Anyway, I'm not really a student of history, and I don't really know if this sword was intended to be specific based on the manuals that he produced or not, but I'm going to dispense with that because I'm not qualified to talk on it. What I can say is, regardless of the namesake, the Type 15A typology from Albion seems to be relatively prolific. And this happens to be one of them. It seems like the Ringek is more popular. There's more examples online or people talking about it. And I can't blame them because I'm not necessarily a fan of the wheel pommel myself. And the Ringek has, a different type of pommel. I can't remember the name of it. A scent stop or a fish tail or something like that. But it has a different type of pommel that I personally find more comfortable, particularly in a sword of this size. Anyway, this one has the wheel pommel. It's called the Fiore. It's a Type 15 blade. And I'll also elaborate a little bit. I have an Albion Mercenary handy. And it's also a Type 15A blade, but it's one of the reasons that the Oakshot typology system is something I just can't quite wrap my head around, because this Type 15A blade between the Albion Mercenary and this feel like fundamentally two different swords. And as an uneducated buyer, I would assume that one Type 15A blade and another from the same manufacturer with slight differences would be closer to the same than they are. Anyway, I'll dispense with that for the moment and just move on to some of the fit and finish. Honestly, no terrible surprises here. You've probably seen me and other reviewers make comments about Albion swords. They're relatively well-made products. This one, despite the surface rust and all that, the build quality underneath has stood the test of time and is really quite good. So no great surprises there. The only thing you'll hear me perhaps complain about is that it's not particularly sharp. That's not necessarily manifest because of the condition that it came in or usage or anything like that. I just don't think it came particularly sharp from Albion, but it has an edge conducive to doing that. So if you want the short review, it's a darn fine sword. And if you want one, I'd certainly recommend it, but I'll go to the long rambly version now. So I'm going to start with the pommel, as I often do, and in a nutshell, it is a really well-done pommel. There's nothing that bites into the fat of my hands as I grab it. I happen to have chunky monkey hands here, and if I put the flub of my hands on here and try to swing the sword around, it doesn't hurt. There's nothing that inherently bites me, and while I haven't swung this sword into anything and met it with a dull thud to kind of give that shock into my hands, I do suspect that as wheel pommels go, that this one is probably among the more comfortable. It does have these kind of large center pieces that kind of jut out, but my hands seem to fit well into them. There's some dimension as well, so it has a very slight and narrow taper down, not necessarily a huge amount. The edges are all tampered and whatnot, so again, it feels comfortable on the hand. At the same time, looking precise, like it has some intentional build around it. The edges aren't soft. It's not like it's been taken under a buffing wheel too long or something like that. Overall, it's good. The peen block is also good. It doesn't look like it has any misplaced hammer marks, or if there are any, they've been finished off pretty well. Seems well done there, and no schmutz and kind of yucky bits in terms of lacquering are left over on the pommel. This area here around the pommel and the subsequent area where the grip meets the crossguard are notoriously challenging to kind of keep clean, and I think this one might serve as an example of that, where getting oil and things like that up into those areas to keep them protected is something of a challenging bit. And when you take the sword off to clean it, your hand might go here, or it might go here to put it on the stand or wherever you happen to put it. And the oil from your hands, I notice, tends to rust those sections probably the most quickly. I've done a reasonable job of cleaning this one up, but that was one of the problem areas that I spotted when I received this particular sword. Anyway, there's the pommel. Not a huge fan myself of wheel pommels, but as wheel pommels go, this one isn't too bad, and I really like the way the wheel pommel meets up with this section of the guard. This shape of grip is one thing that I do really like, and I suppose that does bring us up to the grip. So where the pommel meets the grip here is mostly cylindrical. So as I understand it, if you're using the sword, it allows you to kind of change grips relatively easily. And frankly, I guess I don't know the martial aspect of it and how easy that makes or doesn't make it in comparison to something more elliptical, but it's a particularly handsome shape, if I do say so. I really like the way it happens to look. It has a kind of a very dramatic taper down to a cylindrical shape, this large riser in the middle, which if you want to, not that you would really want to use this sword one-handed, but if you put your hand there for whatever reason to get you at your purchase, it rests really well in kind of the flub of your hand there. And then it has a waisted section near the cross guard as well that also feels really good. It's more elliptical in this area. And honestly, very easy to index, very easy to hold on to. In terms of the ergonomics of the grip itself, I happen to really like the way this one looks, and it's made about the right size. So it's not particularly huge, but my big sausage fingers fit around it really well. And overall, it's a very, very, very comfortable size and shape grip. So if you like I don't know if that matters to you, but there you go. In terms of finishing, relatively straightforward in terms of how Albions are finished. This one has the red coloring on it, and the red tends to look blotchy. So if you're looking for a uniform red, a lot of the examples I see from Albion that use red tend to have kind of different shades of red throughout the grip, and that might be important or not important to you. The lines in terms of the twine used all look really good. This one has some aging to it, but overall I think it's cleaned up pretty well. I don't know if it was like wax or something was put on it or if it was just that it aged, but I cleaned it up and it seems to have come out pretty well. Around the seam of the leather as well, you can kind of make out that it's dark in there. Again, something I tend to see, not necessarily on newer examples from Albion, but certainly on some of the older ones. Around the seam where the leather is wrapped, the edge of it tends to get a little bit darker, so I can make it out pretty easily on this lighter color. But I can't feel it with my hands at all. There's no texture or lip or ledge for me to get any kind of purchase on with my fingernails. Nothing like that. So overall, anyway, there's the grip. Happen to really like it. All right, sword friends, I'm going to talk about the crossguard now. Now, I'm not particularly used to using a crossguard, so I do want to note that this one, I have some bad vibes toward because I've thumped myself in the forehead with it a few times. Not being used to having a crossguard, when I go into high guard, I tend to whack my noodle with these crossguard bits. And the ledge here is not exactly sharp, so, you know, no giant gaping head wounds, but it's sharp enough to certainly leave a dent. So I guess if you want to use it aggressively, it can do that, though it's not necessarily going to do the best job of it. You can irritate your enemy that way. Anyway, in terms of shape, it's a relatively cliche-looking crossguard to me, at least when I think of European swords. This tends to be the shape that comes to mind first and foremost, and it's just well done, as you would expect to see from Albion. There's no particular embellishments on this one, but what it does have, it does pretty well. So the kind of sweeping planes don't have a lot of tool markings or anything like that. They seem overall pretty well finished. The flats are symmetrical. Their ledges aren't particularly sharp, so if you're choking up on the grip, nothing bites into my hands. If you're using a glove or something, even less of a problem. Again, I suppose I'd note that this area underneath the cross guard right here tends to be the hardest one to keep clean. But again, as cross guards go, it's very pretty and it's well done. It's relatively simple, but at the same time, well executed. The gap around the cross guard is also on par with what you'd expect to see from Albion, which means they tend to do it better than most. The gap is relatively small. There's something there. There's a millimeter on one side and not on the other. It's not perfect, but it's overall industry leading, you might say. Not a lot of people put as much effort or at least do it as well as Albion does in terms of the gap where the blade meets the crossguard. Now, is that important? I tend to note this in my reviews, and I tend to say that's one area of improvement that other vendors tend to miss. Historically speaking, I don't think it was really that big a deal. I've been fortunate enough to see a few different medieval swords in my time, and there's a lot of variation. Some gaps and crossguards are big, some are small, some blades, historically speaking, are rehilted, and all of that attention to detail isn't really paid. So from a historical standpoint, no, I don't think so. I don't think it was necessarily that big a deal. But from a modern context, as a modern buyer, if it's something that you find irritating or important, then I guess you know. As a side note, I happen to have the Mercenary out here, and I'll do more contrasting between these two a little bit later, but there is one thing that they share in terms of similarity, which is the crossguard. And you might think by looking at the Albion website that the Mercenary and the Fiore have the same crossguard. Well, similar styling, the Fiore is larger than the Mercenary. You can probably see if I try to line them up here that the Fiore has you know, I would say about an inch on either end of the crossguard, maybe a little bit less. Anyway, it's a wider crossguard, so bigger. All right, sword friends, let's talk about the blade, the pointy, stabby part. And one thing that, well, honestly, there's not a whole lot to say about it. That's not going to stop me from talking for a long time, but it has a strong taper in either direction, as is kind of characteristic, I guess, of the Type 15 or 15A blades. And it, that's mostly it. Diamond cross section all the way through. What you would kind of expect from Albion is here. All the lines are straight. It lines up with the handle well. There's no wavering or anything like that. This one in particular has very clean presentation in terms of grinding. The first two thirds of the blade, I can see a little bit more in terms of surface rippling towards the very end. But overall, it's very clean, very well done. And again, when you're paying a premium price point, this happens to be around $880 right now. You kind of expect a good execution. And that's what I'm seeing on the blade. It's not particularly sharp. That's one common complaint for Albions, but you can certainly make them sharper. They have a profile that lends themselves to that. The blade typology in this particular one seems to be more stab-centric than chop-centric. Not that with a sharp edge, I wouldn't be scared of this, but it certainly seems to favor the thrust more. And it's not particularly flexible either, as you're perhaps able to see. It certainly seems like it is intended to be more of a stabby guy than a choppy guy. But that doesn't mean it couldn't be potentially effective either way. Again, I don't really know how to use the Type 15. I will say that in comparison to the other Type 15s, this one definitely feels like it is a heavier two-handed weapon, more intended to be used by somebody that is experienced and knows how to use it. It doesn't feel necessarily intuitive in my hand. I don't necessarily feel terribly connected to the point. It's not a bad sword at all, but it definitely feels like a long sword, like something intended for two hands, like something that you just have to learn how to use. In contrast, if I break out the Mercenary here, again, on Albion's website, these are both listed as Type 15A swords. And Matt Easton actually did a video on this already where he compared the Albion Mercenary to, or one like it, to the Ringek, which is probably a better equation to make. And similar points that I can make here, I'll link his video down below. He's more articulate than I am. But basically, you know, an inexperienced, kind of uneducated opinion, looking at these pictures online, I would assume that this one, because it looks like a chunky boy, would be heavier and more cumbersome in the hand, and that is, it's the exact opposite. This one feels more agile. It feels like I could get a better cut with it. It feels more connected to the tip, so even though I'm sacrificing reach, I feel like I'd be a lot more accurate with this one. I can use it in one hand. It certainly comes alive in two. I've already reviewed this sword, but the Mercenary, despite its kind of more stout presence, is actually a more comfortable sword by far to use in the hand. I don't feel like I need to study to use this sword, as where this one gives me pause, and it's a lot more cumbersome to move around. I suppose that further emphasizes the point that this is maybe for somebody that knows how to use it. It certainly seems to favor the stab, and it has a much more acute, slimmer at the cross guard, but it's also quite a bit wider. And so despite appearances, it has a little bit more meat on the bone. Anyway, as 15A blades go, it's just worth pointing out because there are a number of 15A blades on Albion's website. And so the pictures might not give you the best impression of what the dynamic characteristics are going to be, at least if you don't know things like I don't. Or like I do. I don't know. You get it. If you don't know, then the pictures are not necessarily self-evident as to how they're going to feel in your hand. If you're curious, I'm suspecting that the Ringek feels probably similar to this, the Mercenary is much more lively than you might give it credit for, at least by appearances. Anyway, 15A blade, not particularly sharp, but overall good build quality. I have no doubt that you could get a very keen edge on this. It has the right profile to do it, just it isn't put there from the factory. So some final thoughts here. Do I think the sword is worth the asking price of $880 without a scabbard? Yes, I do. I see the quality that's there. There are just little attentions to detail in terms of the taper, the dynamic characteristics, the overall build quality that I see in Albion's and I don't necessarily see matched elsewhere. Does it cost more money? Absolutely. Do you get that out of it? I believe so. Is it worth it to you? I guess I don't know that. But as a sword aficionado, collector, I appreciate both. I appreciate swords that are less money and offer more kind of bang for the buck, and I appreciate Albion's. And while the price is higher, I think you certainly get something for that money. So yes, if this sword at $880 has the features, style, you know, if it suits your needs, then I say it's certainly worth the asking price. I think they do a great job. I think it's a great sword. I do also acknowledge, though, that it's not for me. I don't particularly like it. I don't like mostly the way it feels, and wheel pommels are not for me. I think if this were a Ringek, I'd probably appreciate the differences more, but I don't get a lot of joy out of swinging it around. So for me, not so much. I'm probably going to end up doing something else with the sword, selling it, trading it. I'm not exactly sure which way I'm going to go just yet. It's a fun sword, and it's fun to move around. I've liked the style of grip, and I've liked the dynamic characteristics and comparing it to other Type 15A swords. But I just acknowledge that it's not particularly fun for me. I like swords that tend to favor slashy-slashy instead of stabby-stabby. I tend to cut targets as opposed to thrust at them, and I don't study the historical systems that would likely kind of unleash the potential of this sword, so to speak. Anyway, for me, not my style, but I certainly acknowledge the qualities there. Yes, it's certainly worth the $880 if you happen to like the features that it offers. All right, so while the Fiora is a fantastic sword, I do want to just compare a couple other swords that I have here. Food for thought if you're thinking about getting something like the Fiora or Ringek or something with similar characteristics. So if you want a 15A sword, the Mercenary, as I noted, is like that. It was just more fun to move around. You can move it in one hand easily. It certainly comes alive in two. It seems like it's going to be effective in the thrust, but it also seems like it's going to be a little better in the chop. You lose reach. You lose a little bit of rigidity, but at the same time, to me, this is just a more fun sword. So as you're contrasting the two, if you don't know how they feel and you just want something between the two, if you were deciding between the two, know that this one, at least in my opinion, is vastly more fun to move around, and seems like you could use it in more more scenarios, whether it be one-handed or two-handed. You lose reach, you lose rigidity, but I think you gain a lot more fun. One other unlikely comparison that I just happen to have around, it's not necessarily the best comparison, but it is worth making, is the Senpak to the Fiora. So it's a completely different sword, completely different typology. It's got a hexagonal cross-section as opposed to a diamond cross-section. It's got a fuller, but you have similar levels of reach, similar grip sizes, similar. I would say that the Senpak has similar levels of rigidity. It seems to favor the thrust, similar reach, but it has the dynamic characteristics that I like in the Mercenaries. And I can kind of move it one hand. I feel connected to the tip. It comes alive in two, and it doesn't have the flubby wheel pommel that's uncomfortable on my hand. So if you're looking at models to get and you're just undecided, and you like kind of the profile of the Fiora, then just worthy of consideration, the Senpak. I think you can get a different grip on it, or at least the spiral grip, which is something I've had on a different sword, but also I think would enhance the experience. Anyway, that is not necessarily the best comparison to make. They just happen to be the models that I have, and I'm just giving you food for thought if you're thinking about what model to get. All right, folks, I'm going on even more of a ramble than usual. I am going to stop here. Hopefully the review has been interesting. It's given you some stuff to think about. If you have any questions, throw them in the commentary down below, and I will endeavor to answer. As always, cheers, and thanks for watching.